It's been more than a decade since the Bassmasters have contested a top-level event on Seminole.
Woo! Look at there! Boom!
But in March 2014, this legendary lake is the starting point for the Bassmaster Elite Series.
That's a big old pig.
And right out of the box, a legendary angler takes control. Shaw Grigsby, who won here in 1993 and in 2000, has the kind of day that's every angler's fantasy.
I'm culling this one, keeping that one.
A nine-time Bassmaster winner, Shaw Grigsby, has tasted victory here before, and he may just do it again.
4 pounds behind Shaw is another respected Florida veteran, Bernie Schultz, whose day is anchored by the Carhartt Big Bass of the tournament. A 10-pound, 10-ounce giant.
10-10, the biggest fish in history, weighed here on this body of water.
It's also been the better part of a decade since Brett Hyde has fished the Bassmasters.
20 pounds, 11 ounces. B. Hyde keeps on rolling and has his eyes on an Elite Series prize with 45 pounds, 6 ounces.
He marks his return tournament by taking over the lead on day two as Grigsby stumbles.
Yeah! Woo!
On day three, he stretches his lead from less than a pound to almost 10 pounds.
Woo! Let's go, baby.
Then on championship day, it's announced that the fishing will end 3 hours early. A nasty storm line is approaching from Alabama.
Under safety rules, you guys know this, tournament officials have the right to delay, shorten, or cancel the start of the official tournament day because of bad weather or other factors that would endanger the safety of competitors. At 6:33, I got off the phone, Chuck and I did, with the National Weather Service. You guys know what's west of here, thunderstorm watch, tornado watch. So we're going to take off at 7:30. We're going to check in at 1 o'clock.
That wind, she's starting to rock and roll now.
Hyde knows all he has to do is keep his head down, stay the course, and bring this one across the finish line by 1 o'clock.
As the sky opens up, let's bring out our leader, his first ever Bassmaster Elite Series event from Phoenix, Arizona, Brett Hyde. We're gonna get our anglers side by side. One of these guys is gonna be your champion, looking for 13 pounds even. 25 pounds, 15 ounces. B. Hyde wins the fight, becoming the first Bassmaster Elite Series champion of the 2014 season. B. Hyde is your Bassmaster Elite Series Lake Seminole champion.
So there he is, Brett Hyde, one of the hottest guys in the sport of bass fishing, an angler who has not been to the Bassmasters for nearly a decade, fished the old Elite 50 Series, fished some of the top 150s back in the day, but he is back and in a big way. In fact, the first guy as a rookie since Derek Rimmets in 2007 to debut with a tournament victory. Hats off to him, some good stuff from Brett Hyde.
And we're gonna really dive in to Brett Hyde as an angler, but above and beyond that, we're going to dive into this little buddy right here, the chatterbait. If you're to rewind time and look at the Bassmaster Classic on Gunnersville, we about had to highlight it with our second place finisher, Paul Mueller. And there's something about this bait right here, this time of year, especially Brett Hyde, when he has this in his hand. If you're to look at the years and years of Bassmaster history, you look at Denny Brower is being a shallow water guy, flipping. You look at Rick Klun, David Fritz of being crankers. Brett Hyde, he is the chatterbait. We're going to go through this whole show with that bait.
Looking forward to that. Certainly worked very well on Seminole. And speaking of Seminole, hey, this group hasn't been there since 2002, 2003. A lot of them have never fished in a tournament there on the Chattahoochee River, a couple of main tributary rivers as well. Break it down for us real quick.
Well, really, you know, if you look at Seminole, Seminole's gone through so many different transitions. Back in 1994, all of the floods that ripped the grass out, you started to see the decline of all the big bass. Well, right now, Lake Seminole is on the incline. You're starting to see bigger bass, more, you know, 20 to 30 pound bags. And, you know, really after the first day of this tournament, you looked at the history of Shaw Grigsby. The giant
here twice.
Absolutely. Well, he lays down that big bag, and all of us said, this tournament is over. Not. exactly what happened. Yeah, he said those fish were there. That's the second day, he just couldn't catch them, but somebody figured out how to do it, and that guy was Brett Hite. And I'm looking forward to you getting with him, breaking that down with him a little bit later. We'll talk about his strategy. You'll talk about his baits and techniques as well.
And the most amazing key about what Brett Hite did in this tournament was ignoring the crowd. What everybody was doing, the section of the lake that they were in, he stayed away. He did his own thing. High risk, higher reward.
Brett Hite worked through probably the toughest field ever to suit up for the Bassmaster Elite Series. Also worked through some weather as well. Fog delays, which we do have this time of year, especially in the early going on the Bassmaster Elite Series. But the final day being cut down to half a day, that was huge too.
It was definitely huge. But after the day three weigh-in, we interviewed Brett Hite and said, "You're going to bust him up pretty good on the last day, aren't you?" He said, "There's no doubt in my mind."
He made that come true. Hey, we got a lot of stuff coming true on this show today. We mentioned a visit with Brett Hite, two visits with him. In fact, also Mark Davis had a great finish here, continuing his momentum from last season. He'll be in studio. We'll have some fun with him and break down some important stuff as well. A good show coming up.
The Dick Cepek Bass Master Elite Series, presented by Hardees, is brought to you by Triton Boat. Nitro. Toyota. And by Berkeley.
The Dick Cepek Bassmaster Elite on Lake Seminole, presented by Hardees. That's the full name of this first event of the season for the Bassmaster Elite Series. Bainbridge, Georgia. This is our headquarters. Big stuff going on here. Rivertown days. Lots of barbecue cooking. We got great national music acts. Lots of fun for the whole family here on the banks of the Flint River. And this is maybe the strongest field to ever start a Bassmaster Elite season. And the big man in this one, this time around, of course, our winner, the rookie. And more on that later. Brett Hite, but Brett Hite, you know how this works. Somebody always finds something that's maybe a little bit overlooked or underdeveloped. They commit to it, they exploit it fully, and they win the event. That's the case with Brett Hite. Mark Zona, we'll talk to him in just a few minutes about that whole strategy. Right now, let's get out on the water with Brett Hite. The final day, a shortened day, but he finds the conditions to his liking.
Yeah, baby. 3.5. That eases it a lot right there. Now they got to catch 13.5 to even have a shot. Ooh, yes.
So many of the anglers were fishing resident fish, fish that have pulled up, they're there, and you saw those fish disappear through the tournament. You were fishing on highways where there was fish coming to you each day.
That was one of the main goals coming in that tournament. I know how Lake Seminole is. Those backwater fish and pond fish, just like you said, in a four-day tournament, they are not going to hold up. I knew coming in that tournament, the pre-spawn fish were going to be the fish that won that tournament, and that they did. And that's what I looked for. I looked for main body fish.
Ran the drag.
Yeah, that were moving back and forth. That was really what I was keying in on. This area right here has produced quite a few fish. You know, everyone's been fishing up the creeks. During the first couple days of practice, I was in one of the major creek arms, and there was just so much boat traffic. And then I got out here on the main river, main lake, and there's nobody fishing out here, and the bite was better. So, I mean, it's a no-brainer. There was guys fishing out in the main lake, but they're fishing way offshore, shallow reefs and stuff like that. And the fish for me, just, you could catch one every once in a while out there, but it was not consistent. Right at the boat, baby.
Now, you're fishing in what I would call a gut or a trench along the shore, but what a lot of people at home did not see, and a lot of anglers were devastated by the wind. You almost had a block. You had a 3-foot flat that was in between your trench and the main river channel. Did that flat actually knock down the sediment that could have pushed against your bank?
The first day of the tournament, on Wednesday night, on the last day of practice, we had, I mean, gale force winds. When I got to my banks the first day, it was very, very muddy. I didn't know if they were gonna bite, and it took about 5 minutes and 4.5 pounder bit. So I knew that, but it got clearer and clearer. The problem was, at the beginning of the tournament, the wind blew out of the north. My banks were predominantly south banks. So as the tournament went on, and the last day when I saw that wind forecast and you asked me, are you going to catch them? And I said, yes, because I knew the wind was going to be blowing hard out of the south. All my banks were protected.
Yeah, I felt him hit it once and then came back and got it.
Woman Cinco.
Shallow, man. 2 foot right here. I think they might, some of these are up here spawning and you just can't see them, you know? I mean, who thinks out here on the main lake that they, you know, they'll be up here spawning, but that's, I think that's part of what's happening here. Like I clicked something and I could have swore, oh man, that kind of felt like a bite, and I just kept unwinding it slow and all of a sudden, boom, we got one.
Brett Height and Mark Zona will be back in a few minutes to talk about the baits, the techniques, the tools to the big victory. Also looking forward to a visit from Mark Davis right here in studio. He had a great start to his 2014 as well. And we want to know, how's your season going? Maybe as good as, hey, Kevin Witherspoon right there. Pretty darn impressive. Send us your photo. Tweet us your photo. Hashtag Big Catch. We'll be right back.
Here we are, moments away from takeoff at the first Bassmaster Elite Series event of the year. We hit up Bassmaster social media and asked you guys who the 3 best sight fishermen are on tour. You guys said these guys. And now it's time to give our pros 6 seconds to answer that same question. Randall Tharp, ready to play 6 seconds?
Oh, yeah.
The 3 best sight fishermen on tour, not including yourself.
I would say Shaw Grigsby, Jacob Poroznik, and I would
go
Alton Jones, Dean Rojas, and doggone them.
Shaw Grigsby, Ish Monroe, and Aaron Martins.
Got it. Who is it?
Alton Jones, Shaw Grigsby, and Kurt Dove's right here, so him.
Good choice. Bassmaster Classic champion Chris Lane, 3 best sight fishermen on tour, not including yourself.
Shaw Grigsby, Bobby Lane, and Alton Jones.
the three best sight fishermen on tour.
Go.
Everybody's a good.
Aaron Martin, Timmy Horton, Shaw Grigsby. I just threw it out there. I mean,
time's up.
But sure enough, sight fisherman.
Time's up. Go.
Shaw Grigsby. You got me at
a. Dean Rojas, for sure. You gotta go Shaw Grigsby.
Finally found something that Kevin Van Dam cannot win. 6 seconds.
Dave Mercer getting the short version there with 6 seconds. Man, yes. That moves along quite quickly. Bernie Schultz, man, did he get off to a fast start here. A 10-pound, 10-ounce Carhartt Big Bass of the tournament on his way to 26-14 on day one.
10-10, the biggest fish in history weighed here on this body of water. Good Lord, that thing has no Abdullah Oblongata.
Here's Bernie trying to make it happen on the final day. He's got a long, long way to go. Adjustments needed here, right?
Well, Bernie's done basically what the rest of the field's done, except for Brett Hite. Brett Hite has stuck to his guns the entire event. One technique, predominantly one or two areas. You look at Bernie Schultz, Shaw Grigsby, a Mark Davis. All of these anglers have had to adjust their techniques and areas as the tournament has gone along. The reason why, really, this tournament started, the predominant amount of your top 20 were sight fishing. Well, the cold nights have pushed a lot of the fish that were up on the bank off the bank a little bit, and it's been a game of adjusting your technique throughout the week.
Look at him looking at my bait. Look at that. You never see that. God almighty. That almost never happens. Wish a big one would blow up on this thing. You can't call them any better than that. Oh my God. Dude, that's what it's about when you call a shot, or beg for one anyway. Four more, just like that. And I'll give Brett a run for his money.
It's Bernie Schultz. Let's take a look at our leader, how he was operating on day number four, Brett Hyden. He's alone here. Of course, there's only 12 guys on this final day, but has that been the case throughout the whole tournament?
We're going to knock down his technique, his system, with a chatterbait. But the main thing, look over his shoulder. Look at the banks that he's fishing, almost a bluffy-style bank. 95% of Lake Seminole, it's a flat lake. It all looks the same, gator grass, lily pads. He ignored all of that, which in return, he ignored the rest of the field. If you look at that bank, that little bit steeper, almost bluffy style that we're talking about, as long as his boat was sitting in 6 to 8 feet of water and he could still hit the bank, those were the key areas. And those were the key areas where he caught the majority of his weight throughout the whole week.
I don't know what I got. Well, I got one.
Little guy. We'll take him. Another pound. That's four, baby.
So that was Brett Hite operating on day number four, just kind of on cruise control, bringing it in, as you say, having found something that no one else really on by himself. Kind of an ideal situation to be in. Mark Davis started this day in second place, trying to hang on to that second place all during the final day, with Todd Faircloth charging up from 10th place. But as we look at all these catches from Mark Davis, he's pretty dialed in. I mean, not quite Brett Hite style, but he's dialed in.
Very small pockets off of the Flint River, closer to our takeoff, really in between where Brett Hite Height was fishing and our takeoff. And again, another angler like Bernie Schultz that we said, having to adjust every single day and really kind of played this tournament a little bit dangerous. He had a crankbait deal going on throughout practice and said he wanted to wait till days 3 and days 4 to break it out so nobody else would see him.
Good one. Come on, we'll get tired now. Get tired. There we go. That's what we like. Them boys better be catching them, because I've just made up that 10-pound deficit. There's one. Two-pounder. But that's five. That's five pretty dang quick. 5 in 30 minutes.
Mark Davis doing his thing on the way to a strong top three finish there on Lake Seminole. Mark Davis, a man with some momentum, that's for sure. Wrapped up his 2013 season, Detroit River, Lake Erie, and of course all of Lake St. Clair there, finishing second place. So some good stuff going on at the present time for Mark Davis. And guess what? There he is right here, the man of the hour with Mark Zona. Guys, take it away.
Absolutely right, Tommy Sanders. Mark Davis, you look at Brett Height dominating this tournament with one technique, a couple different areas, not running all over. You said you had to change your techniques every single day in this event.
I did, from sight fishing to a pure poison and a 1.5 to flipping and punching, then back to a pure poison and a 1.5 square bill the last day.
And this was, when you say that, talking about a tournament of adjustments though, it's not like you were adjusting all over the lake. In fact, we were just looking at your footage. You were kind of a squatter in this tournament.
I was. I found that a lot of the spawning areas had more fish out in the mouths, and the guys didn't pick up on it. I kind of had it to myself. So I discreetly stayed with those fish in about 3 or 4 different areas, and I fished different each day to catch them.
I'm going
to
give, this is called the Nude Notes and Nuggets of this segment. You ready?
Ready.
Do you like that right there?
That's good.
Thank you. I appreciate that. For anybody at home watching this, you saved how we've been watching your final day, that technique and those fish, because you did not want other anglers to see you fishing that way.
The guys on the Elite Tour are so good. If you give them just any inkling of what you're doing and it's working, it's over. They're gonna run in there and they're gonna say, hey, I'll just go down here.
Now, wouldn't you have felt bad if you wouldn't have made it to the final day?
I would have felt bad, but you've got to have a game plan. You've got to stick with it. And that one area, I did not fish it, especially the first 2 days, because there's a lot of traffic in and out. You know, and the fish were untouched. I watched it. They went untouched. And then finally the last day I fished.
If you would have saw a boat pull out there, would you have joined them then?
Maybe. Good chance I would have.
How did the guys that were running all over Dodge in this tournament, the runners, the gunners in this tournament, why did they not catch them on Seminole?
It was a timing thing. And, you know, a lot of times on a moon phase or a time of the year, you can set fish up to a certain time frame. That was not the case with these fish. One day they bit early, one day they bit late. Other days it was just a slow grind all day, but usually there's a flurry or kind of a frenzy, but it was a timing, but it was never at the same time. You couldn't bank on it. You know, at the last day, I had a spot on it. I knew because I'd been crushing them there early, never got a bite. So you never knew when they were going to bite.
The window changed every day. You just had to wait for it to open.
Exactly.
Now, Mark, real quick, will you stick around? Because we're not done. We've got a few little reindeer games for you here today. We got a few changes. That's the best way to put it here in the Bassmaster studio. You in?
I'm in. I hope, maybe. Oh, please.
The Dick Cepek Bassmaster Elite Series, presented by Hardees, is brought to you by Evan Williams Bourbon. Yamaha. And by Skeeter Boats.
G
changes in your fortunes day to day. Big weight one day, down the next day. Lake Seminole's a little bit exaggerated. We have seen a lot of it, a lot of big moves in that way. But our Diet Mountain Dew breakthrough move, well, we're going to call it Todd Fairclough here on day number four, going from 10th place all the way up into second.
Intersections. You know, whenever I fish a lake that has grass on it, you know, I'm looking for drains that run in on those flats. And that's where the big populations of fish normally live on a lake. You know, what's the busiest thing on a highway? It's an intersection. What's the busiest thing on a lake? That's where most of the fish connect, is at an intersection. Same thing. You know, the last 2 days I did all my damage on a Strike King Pure Poison 3/8 ounce. It's a bladed jig bait. And the key to getting those bites was making contact with the grass, and whenever you would rip that chatterbait out of the grass, that's when those big ones would smoke it. You know, that's typical grass fishing. Whenever you make contact with that grass, when you rip that bait through there, it just creates a reaction bite, and those fish just smack it.
Interesting to watch the places these guys are setting up. A lot of them actively seeking these highways. We think of a flat with grass on it as being the thing. They're looking for things within that are the highways for fish, right?
The most active highway on this body of water really is where Spring Creek and the Flint River connect. It's a highway that reloads all these little backwaters easily and quickly. A lot of our anglers on days one, two, and some on days three, they were in those far reaches, those far backwaters. Really, they just ran out of fish. Those fish live there. The problem is they don't reload like these highway areas, like just off of Spring Creek and the Flint.
All right. That's the way they've been eating it right there.
Never too early to start tracking those Toyota Bassmaster Angler of the Year points. And of course, at this first event of the year, that's going to completely match up with our final leaderboard. So Brett Hite on top, Todd Fairclough making a big jump to grab those valuable second place points. Mark Davis hanging in there, Taka Hiro Amori in fourth place, and Kevin Short rounding out the top five. Now, is there anything better on Bassmaster.com than a James Overstreet gallery? The answer to that is no. But we're going to go you one better here. We're going to get a gallery. We got J.O. himself to narrate it for us. Man, you got some fantastic pictures from Seminole, and you shadowed our leader the final day and part of the day before.
I did, and my choice to follow him on the last day was actually in one of the easiest ones I'll probably have this year. You know, Brett goes into the final day with almost a 10-pound lead. He's one of the hottest anglers on the planet, and he wrecked him. He wrecked 27 pounds in the last hour on day three. Left him biting, and he was chomping at the bit to get back to this spot where he had left that 27 pounds. And it just really all started early. He shows up on his spot the next morning, and it's almost immediate he starts putting good fish in the boat. So, I mean, this is one of his early fish here. And he said on stage that the conditions that he wanted was going to be a real windy day with a lot of clouds. And you can see from the bow, and you can see how much wind we've got here. And you can see the water
chop under there.
But I mean, it's really, it's set up perfect for what he wanted. And he smiled. He said, "This is what I want," and this is what he got. So, I mean, he caught a lot of good quality fish early and often. It was really, from a gallery, from what I do standpoint, it was one of the easiest ones because he caught so many fish. And then as we move along, and they're quality fish, this fish here is going to be a fish that's going to be his best of the tournament.
Yeah.
And this happened in the last hour. And this, it's an 8-pounder that pretty much puts an exclamation point on his tournament, and it's over at this point.
Absolutely. So, exultant Brett Hite right there. And you followed him the day before, and his day really didn't get started till late in the day, and you missed a little bit there. So you were going to be on him first thing this morning because the conditions were different.
And that was kind of a sore spot with me. I left him at 1 o'clock. And then he goes and catches 27 pounds right at the end of the day, and I'm not there. So I talked to him at the dock that morning. I said, "Look, if you're staying till dark, I'm staying till dark." So it all worked out. But this is the 8-pounder that ended his day. Of course, he's all jacked up showing that to the camera. And as you can see, that's a pretty good sack of fish right
there. That's the winning stringer right there. And of course, again, a great lead going into that day. And he builds on it, makes a great impression, his first Bassmaster Elite Series event. Before we drop this right here, J.O., I want your opinion on a little bit of fantasy here. We know that Mark Davis went on to the second event of the year, took over the lead Toyota Bassmaster Angler of the Year points. Now, we got Davis and all the rest of the crew headed up to Table Rock Lake. Let's go to the middle part of the season. After that, we go to Toledo Bend and back up to Dardanelle. Give me two names that our fantasy folks can look for. Maybe you could get in cheap and do well.
I mean, I think if you bypass Table Rock, the next two tournaments after that, being Darnell and Toledo being, there's a couple of obvious names that I would look at based on previous results there. I mean, Dean Rojas would be one of the guys that I mean, he's really, really strong at Darnell. He's won at Toledo Bend. And then I would stick, you got to think that Mark Davis, he's such a strong post-spawn fisherman. Arkansas guy, we're going to Darnell. I mean, when you got a guy, the guys that have momentum, that's kind of the guys I look to in fantasy.
I know you're not saying that because he's still here in the studio. I know you're not doing that, J.O. There he is. Mark Zona told him to stick around after class because you're cooking up something. Let's go see what
quite
this is
possibly,
all about.
Quite possibly the biggest thing we've ever done in the Bassmaster studio right here. And here's what this is called. This is called the Egg of Injustice. Yes. And throughout the year, here's what we're going to be doing. Bringing people in like Mark. Masters of the water, but we will challenge you. We will challenge you not only with this egg, you cannot use your own equipment. We basically grab that stick right there from the closet in the dressing room. And here's the rules in this. Number one, it's as fast as you can knock that egg off of its pedestal. Mark, you cannot hit the pole, and we're gonna crank it off right now. Are you ready, Mark Davis? It's as fast as you can do it. As many pitches as you need.
Till it falls.
Yeah.
How many
casts does it take?
On your mark, get set, and go. The inaugural one.
Can you hit it on the backslide?
You cannot hit it on the backslide.
See, and the other side. He makes up the rules as we go.
Yeah, it's absolutely right. It took us 6 months to come up with this game.
Ooh, close.
The other side of this game, the winner at the end of the season on Bassmaster.com will get an all-expense-paid trip.
That's it.
That's it. Okay, exactly. Right back to studio at some given time.
Oh, yeah.
Done. 31 seconds. 31 seconds. Mark it. I am not going to lie. Number one, you being the only one that's done this, you are our leader right now. Tommy Sanders, fair to say, a very, very impressive time.
High mark to shoot for the rest of these guys who are coming in to the Toyota Bassmaster Studios through this upcoming season. We will see how well it holds up. Meanwhile, join us in just a moment. We'll come back, continue our conversation with Brett Hyde. Mark Zona will talk to him about the tools, the techniques, everything that contributed to his victory. Don't go away.
Well done.
Dick Cepek Tires Bassmaster Elite Series on Lake Seminole, presented by Hardees. And Lake Seminole, what a fantastic part of the show this has been today. One of the legendary spots, one of the places where bass fishing as sport fishing was really developed in this country, and it's so beautiful. Just a classic, classic looking place as we get some incredible views here. And how about making that our Evan Williams shot of the day, the big lizard there as we are here on the border between Florida and Alabama and Georgia. Just an incredible place, an incredible effort going on day four with Brett Hyde. A little bit later, he'll sit back down with Mark Zona, and then we'll go through that chatterbait and all the techniques he used to notch this huge victory here. But right now, Brett Hyde, day four, getting it done.
This is a 3/8 ounce. I'm switching back and forth from a 3/8 and a half. This is a 3/8 here. I'm just up a little shallower. You want to make sure it's real centered so that the bait runs true. Take you a dab of super glue. Gotta have this. Slide it up there. That's what you got. Looks like a little bluegill.
This bait, when you look at a chatterbait, you've become the master of this. When you think of different techniques, Shaw Grigsby's a sight fisherman, Van Dam's a cranker. You have become the man with this. And what's amazing to me, you keep it very simple with this, and really, you don't use a lot of colors at all.
No, I mean, literally, you want a green color, black and blue, and some kind of shad pattern, whether it's, you know, chartreuse and white, or, you know, maybe a crystal shad or something like that, but very, very simple.
Predominantly, though, this green pumpkin one, this is the money.
That's the money maker.
Okay, your trailer on here, and this is probably what we get the most questions about. you've been known to throw a Lake Fork tackle trailer a lot, but in this tournament, you transition.
Yeah, I've all through my career, I kind of, just like somebody asked me, oh, do you only throw one trailer? I'm a chatterbait fisherman. I have four or five different chatterbaits on the deck at all time. And obviously, swim and Senko has always been a really good one for me. It's a little bit more subtle. Obviously, I cut it down. This is a 4.5 inch. I cut it down. Sometimes when I want that bait to be up in the water column a little bit more too, this is a little bit lighter bait, so it allows the chatterbait to stay up in that column.
Why the black blade? I notice none of your chatterbaits that I ever see you throwing have a silver blade, a gold blade.
I think it just looks more natural. You know, I think they want to see, they want to feel that vibration. They're not looking for the flash. And I've never seen a bluegill with a big shiny head on him.
Why do you accept, you see guys that pick it up, they'll throw 20, everybody in this tournament threw a bladed jig. Literally 80% of the field.
Sure.
Why do you excel with this?
I have confidence in it, and I throw 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 it. And I know when I find the right area with all the right ingredients, grass being number one key, good grass. We all know good, healthy grass produces big bass.
Why does this shine on lakes like Seminole? We're looking at your footage right now. Why does this shine on grass lakes where a lipless does, and yet on lakes where there's no grass, it's not as powerful?
Yeah, I mean, it is powerful, but it doesn't draw those giant stringers. It is so productive through grass just because you can fish it efficiently. More so than even a rattle trap or a lipless crankbait. You can fish it super efficiently, and the way that when you hit grass, the deflection and the erratic action it gives this bait, that's what triggers the big strike.
That's a big one. Yeah! Swim and Senko, baby.
Close your eyes right now and describe what you think is going on under the water on the spots you caught them in Seminole.
What's happening is you have a shallow flat coming off the bank, but it's with maybe 20 feet of shallow flat, and it comes off and it rolls right to, you know, that 6 to 8 foot of water. Yep, right on the break, and that's where the best grass was growing, was on that break. And so those fish are sitting on the break, just like bass stereotypically do, sitting on that bank. Chatterbait comes off the bank and comes through the grass, boom, that's where they hit it.
Talk about the really 2 to 3 week window in the spring. You throw it all year long.
Sure.
Dude, there is a magic window though in the spring. Nothing competes with this. What goes on?
You know, I've combined like almost this, the chatterbait is almost like a square bill crankbait, and then I've combined a swim bait trailer, because the only thing that can compete, but it doesn't happen on all lakes, is a swim bait with a chatterbait. We all know that, like Clear Lake. I mean, if you get on the right deal in that same window,
you've combined them all.
Yeah, you combine them all. So that's really what you have, the deflection purposes of a square bill that's super weedless with a swim bait trailer.
And watching you throw this, I mean, you've got a whole system from the rod, a graphite rod, to the reel, to fluorocarbon line. When you're launching that out, you're just not going.
No, it's a glass rod. Heavy glass rod is super key. I want it to have a big parabolic action, because when they hit it so aggressively that I want the rod to take that load up and let that fish actually get that bait. Especially a lot of time, I caught the 6 pounder on the last day and it ate it with maybe 3 feet of line out. So I want that rod to, so you don't rip the bait out of the fish's mouth.
I know, when I'm watching you fish it, it looks like you're feathering it. You're just not pumping it.
No, I'm reeling it, and the key is I want it to hit the grass. Whether I have to have the rod tip up when it's shallow,
or rod tip down when it's deeper. But when it hits that grass, I'm gonna pop it like that, or I'm gonna pop it, because by actually twitching the rod, unlike a square bill, I can twitch the rod and give the bait the same erratic action that it does is if it hits the grass.
Now, we call you a rookie on the Bassmaster Elite Series. I'm gonna say you've been around a very long time and I followed your career. You took a timeout. You took a timeout in 2006, came back in 2007. Has this saved Brett Height?
You know, it's really opened my eyes to coming.
You understand what I'm trying to say.
I totally do. It's opened my eyes to grass fishing. Arizona boy coming into this, you know, coming back east and fishing the top 150 for 5 years. Arizona, we don't have any grass. So it really opened my eyes on how to fish grass. And now I would say fishing, I mean, any type of grass is one of my strong suits. But I mean, I've won a lot of money on this thing, and it's my confidence bait. So yeah, I guess it has saved me. I mean, if you guys want to call me the chatterbait master, that's fine. But I mean, that's my deal. I mean, I throw it all the time, but when it's that time of year, it's pretty magical.
You pretty much knew going into this final day, it was game over.
I knew with the conditions that we had and what I know about that bait, they were gonna bite real well, and they did. I mean, I would have loved to stay out there a couple more hours, because I had a couple other opportunities that it would have been, I really wanted to get one of those 100-pound belts.
Oh my gosh.
Brett Height putting the icing on the cake. A dominant day, a dominant week on Lake Seminole for him. We'll be back here to wrap it up from Lake Seminole. Take a look ahead to a big fish event on the St. John's River and beyond to Table Rock when we come back.
The Dick Cepek Bass Master Elite Series, presented by Hardees, is brought to you by Bass Pro Shops. Humminbird, Mercury, and by Minn Kota.
Dick Cepek Tires, Lake Seminole Bassmaster Elite Series event presented by Hardees. That's number one this year for the Bassmaster Elite Series, and a great return, Mark Zona. And some of these guys have never been to Seminole before, but the lake showed out well. A lot of guys had big days, but only one guy made it work every day.
Yeah, and really, if you look at this beatdown, that's what it was.
Sure.
I don't know if you could put it in the category of a Seahawks Broncos beatdown, not that far
I
off.
Think so.
And you can really credit it to two things, Tommy. You can credit to that he did his own thing. He found an area of the lake that was being ignored. But Brett Height, make no mistake about it, he is the chatterbait kid, Tommy Sanders. And, you know, looking at this tournament, when we were done, you look at the Bassmaster Elite Series field. We've covered a lot of tournaments together the last decade. We have never seen a field like we have, whether it's the usual suspects from the Bassmasters, the guys that have come over from the FLW. Look at Justin Lucas, Randall Tharp, Brett Height. Bud,
yeah,
this is a stock list of pros.
Bigger and badder than ever. We saw some good big fish at Lake Seminole,
whoa,
but when we show you next time on what we got coming from the St. John's River,
mm-hmm.
Oh, unbelievable. Yeah. We got the big fish there.
We have a big fish beat down there by one angler.
Sir.
We're gonna get Chris Lane's take on what exactly transpired.
All right, and after that, we're going up Table Rock Lake, a whole different sort of scenario up there.
And if you look at Table Rock Lake, you know, the thing is, the winter that we've all been experiencing, it's going to affect this tournament probably the most for this time of year. The cold temps, they have this lake way back. And not only that, it looks like a Chinese dragon.
It is. It looks like the new year.
I love it.
And you're going to love our coverage on Bassmaster.com. This one takes, but that's great right there. The 3rd through the 6th of April at Table Rock, Bassmaster.com. We will have the War Room presented by Lowrance. We'll have Bass Track for you there. All sorts of galleries, all sorts of videos on Basscam. It will be wall-to-wall coverage. Hope you will tune in for all that. Hope you'll see us next time here on the Bassmaster Elite Series.